A choice.
Where are they?
Choose between one life or the other.
Don't kill me! Don't kill me, man!
I'm not going to kill you. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to tell all your friends about me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
What's up, everybody, and welcome back to the Z-Mam Show as we're continuing our Batman talks to extend to the interesting history that the Batman movies have had over the last, good Lord, what are we talking, Adam, almost 60 years, give or take?
Yeah, pretty close to it. 55, 60 years. 55, I think.
So, you know, a lot of us, maybe older ones or so forth, maybe some of the younger ones too, may remember the old 60s Batman wonderfulness with Burt Ward and Adam West.
Of course, like just the it was campy by design, and everybody loved it for that reason.
Absolutely, and it was the time. That's what everything was about. Music and movies, just in general, everything from the Beatles and all the other ones. I mean, it was just kind of silly cinema, and it was a lot of fun. And I even watched it as a kid when I was growing up over at my great aunt's house. You know, we turned on, I'd watch the different episodes, and I was like, yeah, this is goofy, but it was fun.
Yeah, same bad time, same bad channel.
Same bad channel, and we'll always love it because of that. But what I was interested to talk about a little bit today is, as the 90s started coming in, and cinema was really finding itself, and we had a lot of great movies coming out in the 90s, and we think about like Jurassic Park and just a lot of the other fun ones where cinema was just becoming to its greatest heights, you get the release of Batman with Michael Keaton, right? And Michael Keaton played an amazing Batman. I think that can be said, right?
I think for years he was regarded as the gold standard for Batman, and you know, kind of comparing it back to Adam West, and they did have a Batman the movie, like that was very campy, cheesy, good fun, had sound effects and words on the screen,
right?
And then all of a sudden you get this, you know, like I remember going back and watching like the first sequence of Keenan's Batman, you know, basically going after some people who had just basically some shoplifters, and how he kind of instilled fear in those shoplifters.
Mm-hmm.
And really, I mean, the comics had already had a really dark feel to him, but I think in many ways, Michael Keaton's Batman was really the first time that darkness was kind of brought to a wider audience. And I think it's responsible for why Batman is not just successful in the comics, but in cinema as well.
Absolutely. And think about it, though. The movie was very dark in general, the way it was shot, a lot of the scenes. I mean, it's not a happy-go-lucky, bright type scene. I mean, the Batcave, very dark, very simple. Of course, technology, we were still working its way out there in the early 90s. But all the same, it was a lot of fun. But he also had a great supporting cast. And I mean, Jack Nicholson. Someone could say that, no, Jack Nicholson made that. You know, that was his movie. He was extremely good. I mean, that Joker, he was dark, but yet he brought that humor, but it was dark humor and just a fun time.
Yeah, and we'll get into this a little bit later, but he was so good to the point that when The Dark Knight was coming out, there were many people that thought, how could Heath Ledger ever best Jack Nicholson? And we won't go into that right now, but I mean, he was
absolutely
that good.
Let's hit back on that in just a few. So what I find interesting is you go from this Batman, which was released, I had to look at me, it was 89, right? And then about mm-hmm. three years later, you get Batman Returns. And it's interesting to see, now you have to think about who the director was.
Was it? Yeah, it was still Tim Burton, though, right?
It was. And I don't know, Tim was still kind of exploring, you know, his style of cinema and stuff, because it was interesting how they used Danny DeVito's character, the Penguin, and also Michelle Pfeiffer's Catwoman. And then just, you know, some of the humor that was used in there. I mean, it was dark, but yet it was starting to get kind of goofy in some ways. Do you know what I mean?
I agreed. Like, you know, I don't want to give away too much, but you know, Catwoman has this scene at the end with Christopher Walken, and this was before Christopher Walken's more cowbell days. He was still serious, widely regarded as a serious actor, even if he had a comedic twist. I mean, like, it was supposed to be serious, but if you go back and watch it now, it like there's still almost this kind of comical twist to it. Like I think it was I know what you mean. Like I remember enjoying the movie, but right. I personally believe it was a step in the wrong direction. And maybe that's kind of what you're hinting at.
I think I am. And you know what? And I don't think it's so bad. I don't think it was necessarily Tim Burton as a bad director and not even bad actors. But I think the story was a little rough. I think it was written a little rough. That's my take on it.
Because, and maybe it was just so hard to pass, you know, to follow Jack Nicholson's Joker as well.
I mean, the Joker is obviously the most awesome villain when you talk Batman in the DC series. I mean, it can be argued, whatever, you know, there are some other cool ones, but the Joker, he's got a lot of character to him, and that's what makes him awesome. The Penguin, yeah, he's cool and all, but he's a penguin. I mean, he uses a bunch of little penguins that is, you know, with rockets strapped to their asses, you know, to try and protect the city. Anyways, interesting premise, not a terrible movie, but you're going to start to see this is how, you know, you start off with this shabam, you know, with Batman 89, and then you see Batman Returns, you're like, okay, I guess, whatever. And then we skip forward a few years to around 95, and we get Batman Forever, which I must admit, and it's part of my childhood, I don't hate the movie. I don't either. I don't hate it. But, I mean, I think if someone young today were to go out and watch it, they'd be like, what is this POS? And, you know, why did you have me go out and watch this? But I think it'd be important for you to watch it because it gives you history. It gives you history to understand where Batman was going and why the Nolan films got so much had to happen to bring this back.
Well, and just like how Batman Returns was a transition to Batman Forever, Batman Forever was a transition to what we'll next talk about, Batman and Robin, in that like it was not super colorful, but it was a little more colorful. You know, like Val Kilmer was Batman. His relationship with Nicole Kidman's character, it was more playful, significantly more playful than what you're used to in a Batman movie. And so even though there was still an element of darkness to it, like Jim Carrey was dark, but he was still Jim Carrey.
He was Jim Carrey. Bright green and just like his attitude, right?
And so, like, I think you're right. It was kind of more of that transition away from the dark and serious into maybe a little sillier, and in this case, a little bit lighter. And I think it wasn't atrocious, but it was still, like you said, a continual step in the wrong direction.
So think about, just skipping forward just a little bit for half a second here, think about Two-Face, you know?
Yeah.
And think about what he looked like in The Dark Knight. And then
compare
it back to Tommy Lee Jones, Tommy Lee Jones is a phenomenal actor. Great. But bad casting choice, I think, for Two-Face. I mean,
maybe.
I mean, but by the way, for that movie, it worked because you had him and he was over the top. Jim Carrey was over the top. And I think there was no other way that it could be played. I mean, given what they were given. There really isn't. I mean, they had to go all out or it was going to be a terrible performance, which some could say, well, Mike, it already was a terrible performance. Like, yes and no. I don't think they had any other choice to go any other direction. You know what I mean?
Well, it's funny, too, because I read an article once about how someone tried to argue that Batman Forever was not a bad film. They didn't try to argue it was good. They just tried to argue it wasn't bad. I think it is kind of in that weird territory where, like, you either like it or you don't, but you could find people who will make arguments for it either way. It's not, I don't think it's anybody's favorite Batman. Well, it's not many people's favorite Batman movies, but it's not atrocious either. It's somewhere in the middle.
Yes.
I think you're going to get some wiggle room. It's got, all of the Batmans have had great acting casts, and this one's no exception. I don't think it was quite, wasn't in train wreck territory yet, if you know what I mean.
not completely. No, I believe that. Yeah, no, I believe a few years later from that, which literally 2 years later, Batman and Robin 97. Now that was atrocious. Okay.
Well, and I think honestly, sorry to cut you off. I think you're honestly, they, you know, you talk about that Adam West kind of campiness, colorfulness. I almost think, I don't know if they purposely did it or not, but it's almost like they threw back to it and it just blew up in their face. I think fans had seen that Michael Keaton, dark, dreary Batman.
Yeah.
And I think this new colorful, you got Arnold Schwarzenegger doing his one-liners, chill. And I think people are just like, what is this? And it just
backfired.
Yeah, it wasn't what people wanted out of Batman anymore. Maybe it was back in the Adam West days, but people had moved on.
And it's a very good point. It's like, and let's face it, a lot of production companies, they take risks. And that's the whole point of cinema. And maybe you said, maybe they would thought, you know, for the kids and for this and that, you know, this is what we need if we want to get the kids and the families in there, because that's right. You got to think about target audience. Who were they trying to get in there? And at the time, I think they were like, well, listen, Michael Keaton is almost, you know, his Batman is almost a little too dark for the young kids, too scary. I mean, hell, I wouldn't let my kids watch those early ones yet. It's just too much. But so if we can get him in here, then we need to get this a little campy. It needs to be goofy. So if anything, I'd say that's absolutely the reason why Batman Forever in Batman and Robin, even though it is still a little risque, you know, like I said, with Batman and Nicole Kidman's relationship, so forth. But yeah, but Batman and Robin, George Clooney, God bless you. Great actor. Love him. But I don't know. That didn't work out. And Alicia Silverstone coming in as Batgirl. And, you know, and I'm forgetting who played Robin. What's his face?
Chris O'Donnell, I think.
Yeah, good call. Chris O'Donnell. You know, again, all decent actors in their own way. And, you know, again, is the movie a complete piece of crap? I mean, it's close to it. But, I mean, I might watch it again just to kind of, just for nostalgic reasons. But that's about it. I'm not going to be like, man, tonight, Batman and Robin, we're watching. You know, it's going to be great.
And you know, it's funny, and let me apply my brakes if I'm going too fast, but the taste left in my mouth from Batman and Robin, and like the first few times, actually when I first watched it, I was like, it's whatever.
Right.
But like the more I watched it, the more I'm like, what is this really offering for me? To the point where like, fast forward like 8 years later when the Nolan Batman movie comes out, like I remember when I went and saw that, I was in college at the time, I went and saw that because I was at home and bored. And I was already going to go see it later that week with some friends. And my dad's like, hey, you want to go see the new Batman movie? And I'm honestly like,
yeah.
I'm like, it's fine. It's better than just sitting around the house. Like I had no, like everybody around me was like, oh, it's new Batman. I'm like, I didn't really even know who Christian Bale was at the time.
Agreed.
I hadn't really known much about Christopher Nolan. He already had some hits. He was the director of the movie. And I'm just like, really? Another Batman movie? You're rebooting it? Didn't we already go there? So I don't know.
But, and I do want to head right into the Nolan ones. Just don't forget who the director was of Batman Forever and Batman and Robin. It was the same director. It was Joel Schumacher, okay? And I had to look him up for a minute because I had to remember a few of the other movies. And I was like, God, Joel Schumacher. I'm like, why do I remember that name? And why do I thinking that I like this guy? Well, because he directed The Lost Boys. Okay. And I think that was in 87, and a great vampire thriller, but yeah, comedy and horror all just mixed in. It was just a great, great 80s film. It's beloved by many, and especially a cult following. And he's had some other good ones too throughout the years. I mean, I wouldn't say amazing, but that Falling Down one with Michael Douglas, I mean, that was in the 90s. That was a pretty dark one. And then he had A Time to Kill, 8mm. And a couple others, Phone Booth, that was just okay. But he's had a very interesting directing past. But the Batman ones, I'm not so sure that was his forte, you know? Yeah.
And like you said, maybe it was a risk he took and it just didn't pay off.
Right. I mean, they got to find a director. And I don't know all the history about it. I don't want to let this video go too long and in depth. But it's interesting sometimes to see the directors and where they came from. And like you said, getting straight into it. You have Nolan, right? Christopher Nolan and his movies. And he did the awesome movie Memento, which I hadn't seen for years.
Yeah.
I think it came out, I don't know if it was like early 2000s or something like that. I think around there.
It was right around the year 2000.
Yeah. And I had never seen, when I finally saw that movie, I'm like, wow, what an acid trip of a crazy movie, you know?
Yeah.
And it was just great. It was great. And, you know, knowing that, but like you said, going into the Nolan movies, no, I didn't even hear a whole lot of press on it, to be honest. I mean, yeah, sure, you had a trailer out here and there, but was I like, ooh la la, you know? No, it's just like, let's go see what this movie's about. And gosh dang it, man, you want to talk about coming out completely satisfied and pleased. I mean, it was just amazing. The feels, I am all about music and cinema. Like, I've said in some of my other older videos, but the gentleman who does all the music Hans for the Zimmer. Star Wars. Oh no, well Hans Zimmer, but John Williams. I think it was John who said it, that music is 50% of the cinematic experience. I absolutely 1,000% believe that. I mean, yes, obviously without the actors and everything else going on, you can't have the movie, but music is so important. It drives the emotion. It really does. And right. that score in there, because you're like, said Hans Zimmer is the one who did the score. What an amazing, amazing, those drums, you know,
yeah.
When you're finally getting up to its height and Batman was making his first real appearance with the tumbler and everything else, when that music was going off and he's flying over the rooftops and, you know, the cops like, he's flying on rooftops, you know what?
Yeah.
Dude, I'm just like, I'm almost getting goosebumps right now. It was just so fun and amazing. And that heightened, the music just keeps dun, 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 you know, and you're just like,
yeah.
You're just waiting to see that next turn. If any of you who have come across this video, and I'm going to let you go, Adam, if you have never gone and seen any of those, if you're just like, I'm not a superhero fan, I'm not a Batman fan, just go watch Batman Begins. Just that one right there. You may change your mind, at least for some superhero cinematic experience.
Yeah, and kind of adding to the music thing, like I remember, like I told you, I went and saw it with my dad, and I remember going into it, like, I'm like, you know, I like watching movies, so I wasn't disappointed to be there, but I wasn't expecting anything. And it has like that, there's one of the like the main theme, it has that, like, you talk about the drums, it's like, and like the movie starts out and it's got that kind of that bass backdrop to it. And like, nothing's even happened yet. It's just a black screen.
And the music's showing, already capturing you.
And I'm just like, what's gonna happen next? And like it you're right, like I think you're right, Hans Zimmer had a lot to do with that. But yeah, just also I think the thing that it did better than any movie that came, Batman movie that came before it, is it really, like, Batman Begins is a true origin story. It really dives into the psyche of Bruce Wayne and how he became Batman. And by the time the movie ends and he's done what he's done, there's no question as to
how he
got where he was, why he did what he did. Like, you know that character. And I think that to me was why, like, it wasn't just a Batman movie. It was just a great character study. And everything he does just makes sense.
It just makes sense. It was a great story, right? Yeah. Great origin story. I think the first 30 to 45 minutes is literally still him just kind of getting ready to, you know, leave for this or that reasons or whatever. Anyways, it's wonderful. And when a few years later, it gets backed up with such a strong beginning, and then you get The Dark Knight.
Go ahead. No, please.
You started off.
I think many still think this is the gold standard. There are a few out there who think it was a little too dark for them. I will say, like, you know, earlier I said that I know several people who are like, how is anyone ever going to top Jack Nicholson's Joker in Michael Keaton's Batman? And let me tell you, Nicholson was good. Ledger was better. I mean, wow. Many people's favorite movie. Just like, I mean, the thing that had me on the fence about, like, the Joker is the antithesis of Batman. Like, to Batman's attraction to order and protection, the Joker is all about chaos and uncertainty. And I have never felt more unsure about what was going to happen next due to a villain's action watching that movie for the first time.
That is exactly what I'm over here thinking. That's exactly what I was going to come back on. It's like, I never knew what that dude was going to do next. And someone could say, well, of course, Mike, you haven't seen the movie. No. Heath Ledger's character, Joker, you did not know what this unpredictable, crazy man was going to do. I mean, Alfred said it best in there. Michael Caine, he goes, some people just want to watch the world burn. And that was Joker. I mean, that is who his character was built on. There was such a great understanding of Heath Ledger and what was to be achieved with this. And I think he even talked with Jack Nicholson, not only on how he wanted to play the character, but also just on dealing with some of those stresses of playing such a sadistic character. Because, I mean, that's a lot, especially for a mind who just can't take those kinds of things. And unfortunately, it took its toll on Heath, God rest his soul. You know,
he was taking medication to help with sleeping problems, I think he was having due to playing that character, and he literally overdosed on that medication.
Yeah, it's a damn shame. I mean, everybody has their demons to deal with, and but I'd like to think that, not that it's a payoff. I mean, I'd rather have him alive, but to know that his legacy will be left with that movie, he will be remembered for generations to come, and I'd like to think that's something good to, you know, leave off on that note for him.
Yeah, I mean, if you gotta go, may as well go like that, right?
Yeah, and like, is it Chadwick Boseman who just passed?
Right.
With the Avengers again, so sorry for his family and everything that's going on with them. You know, I just you look at a young man so strong, so powerful, you know, and playing such a great performance. Not to get off on a tangent, I know because we're talking DC, but it hurts. It's a shame to see something like that happen for sure.
Yeah, it's weird.
But anyways, getting back to the Batman and where we're going with this. So you have this strong Batman Begins, you get the Dark Knight and amazing performances, and then it even finishes off strong with the Dark
Agreed.
Knight Rises. And because it left off on kind of that, I don't want to call it a cliffhanger, but it was more like you're like, oh man, now Batman's on the run, what's he gonna do? And it just starts off. I mean, there is no Batman. He's chilling, right?
Yeah.
He's well and chilling, more like he's done. I mean,
yeah, it the Joker, I think, more or less breaks his spirit in The Dark Knight. Not to give away too much,
well,
but like, and I think.
not just the Joker though, but remember, and I just want to hit on this real too, because let's talk it. Two-Face.
Yeah.
I mean, Joker was a bad villain, and I think it took a lot out of Batman to fight him. But really, I'd want to say that it was Two-Face that broke his spirit, because he saw a great man, you know, a leader, someone they could trust, whatever, turn to a monster, right?
Yeah.
And he has to take the fall and become the bad guy because of that. Now, again, I mean, I'm not saying I'm perfectly right on this, but I just feel like that was such a huge take, you know, a hit
Yeah,
for
and
Batman.
I agree with you, but I think my where I was coming, I think we're in agreement because I would argue that the Joker created Two-Face and that Two-Face by extension created the Batman. So I think the Joker was kind of the
Well
master
put.
puppeteer of the whole thing. And
True
yeah,
that.
I think it was that particular instance that really drove him to it. But I think
Yes.
the Joker was pulling the strings the whole time. But
It's true. It's
so
true.
kind of getting back into what you were saying though, like
Good point.
you're right, like he's like a ghost at the beginning of that movie, and like
Right.
and he tries to get back into it. I mean, basically it just doesn't work out for him.
So tell me just your thoughts on it, if you can remember back to when you were first, well, not first, but when you've seen the movie, but when you finally see him jumping back into action and that music finally comes back in, and Hans Zimmer, you know, I mean, I couldn't help but I started getting really excited, you know, like
Yeah.
I was just like, oh, he's back, you know, and maybe a little bumpy on the road, but he was back in the saddle. And you know, seeing him, you know, so hurt in the beginning, you know, and trying to get back to it, and then when he finally gets out there on the road and all the cops are trying to follow him and so forth, and they still can't keep up with his ass, I was just like, man, this is good. This is good, you
Yeah,
know.
it kind of captured the feel of the first movie in the trilogy, but also kind of captured the fact that he's an outlaw now and the police need to bring him in.
Yeah, the total outlaw, and but yeah, still managed to evade. And great villains, you know, Bane played by Tom Hardy. Hey, you know, shout out there, what they did with his voice, how they got it all down. The female role, and I apologize, I forget her name at the moment, but I will flash a picture up of her. She did a great job, being the villain as
Are you talking
well.
about Selena Kyle? Or
Yes. Oh
not
no.
Anne Hathaway's who played Selena Kyle, that's right.
Right. And I'll look that up for a moment, but either way, it'll be shown in the background of the video. But the point being that just throwing that twist at you, which I didn't see coming, I did not see it coming, you know. And this whole concept of throughout the movie of this, you know, rising and falling, you know, and he truly has to rise, not only his mind, his body, but he has to get out of this freaking cavern just to, you know, make it out, and showing him how he keeps failing. That's what I liked about Nolan's Batman movies. It's like Batman's not just a do-all, always win. I mean, he can be broken and was broken
Right.
several times, and
He's very human.
especially after all he had been through, and he gets jacked up once again. And anyways, gives me chills still to today. Great trilogy of movies, will always be remembered, and so far is the complete rock foundation for Batman as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, I no argument from me.
So we've had this fun, we come up to Nolan and so forth, and now we head into an interesting era of Ben Affleck coming into Batman, which, like every new Batman, everybody's like, oh, I don't know, right? I mean, we never know who we're going to get, right? I mean, right. Is it going to be our George Clooney? You know, is it going to be our Val Kilmer, our Michael Keaton even? Which I think Michael Keaton even has a role in one of the future movies coming up.
Yeah, he does.
Right?
Yeah, he's gonna play in like an older Batman in the future,
which is cool. I mean, so they have all these different universes going on, and you know what? I'm fine with that. Let's have some fun. You know,
yeah.
I mean, you don't want to confuse the audience, but as long as they understand, well, no, we're in a complete separate universe, and this is where we are. In fact, they're about to start doing that with Star Wars. I just found out, but that will be for another video. but more to come. It's pretty exciting news. So you have this Ben Affleck coming in, and let's face it, he did not play a bad Batman, right? We talked about this.
No, I think that he did a lot with what he had.
Which wasn't much.
I mean, like, one of the things that I want to really scream out is, like, one of the big issues people have with Batman versus Superman is, for whatever reason, they decided that Superman and Batman were going to bond over the name of their mom. I mean, like, that is a really, really difficult thing to sell. But I mean, I think what, to me, what Ben Affleck did well is he brought a grittiness to Batman, like probably maybe even more so than Bale in that regard. And he was still a very convincing Bruce Wayne. So I really do think that I think he had the dynamic of playing both sides of that down pretty well. And I think with a better story, he could have really soared. But I just think he had to work with what they gave him.
And that's it right there. Story. A good, solid story. The foundation for any film before it should even get into production, well, definitely production or even pre-production for that matter, you have to have a great story. And let's face it, it didn't have it. And it, for so much more that when the next movie, Justice League, it failed even further. Again, the story, it's almost like there's so much going on and the audience is just kind of sitting there like, huh? You know?
Yeah.
Or when they do finally come together, like you said, like, you're like, we, there's so many memes and so many jokes on it. Like we have the same mother's name, you know, and it's just like, right. It's just like, oh, you know, and by the time you get to the end of Batman vs. Superman, and Superman takes that huge hit from the villain and so forth. I mean, I'm like, you know, I felt bad because I like Superman. I love Man of Steel. I love it. It's a great movie score. Once again, as always, the score is just amazing, but I loved his story. I love the story and the character that he's playing. But yeah, I mean, you want to talk about just taking a 180. It's just kind of like, it's just not working. And we were talking about this earlier. I'm going to let you kind of talk about it if you wish, Adam, just rushing the franchise.
Well, and to quote another good friend of mine, like, you look at what Marvel did with their cinematic universe. I mean, they released the Iron Man movie in 2008 with the premise of, we're just going to see what happens. And by the time the Avengers rolled around four years later, they had Black Widow had appeared in an Iron Man movie, and they had an origin story released for each of their characters, except for the Hulk. Well, even the Hulk had an origin story in Edward Norton's film.
Yeah, they had some.
But they made up for it by focusing a lot around the Hulk and the Avengers. And I feel like, the Avengers, I mean, like, it wasn't, like, it didn't win any awards. But, like, it was a solid, enjoyable film. And I think the reason is Marvel was very patient with laying the groundwork for the cinematic universe. And I think what happened is, like, 6-7 years later, DC comes all the scene and, we're going to do it all. We're going to do it now. And it shows. Like, they're just like, boom. You know, 3 years later, we got Superman. We got Batman. We got Batman versus Superman. We got Dawn of Justice. And they have some hits in there, like Wonder Woman. Aquaman was good. But, like, really, it just felt rushed.
Yeah, I have not seen Aquaman yet, but I will be watching it in the next upcoming weeks because it's just been in the back burners when to get done. I did see Wonder Woman. I really, really liked it. I am super psyched, actually, for Wonder Woman 1984. One, because it's Wonder Woman. One, because it's 1984. I mean, yes, we were born in 83, so it's like, oh, are you truly? But, I mean, 80s, we still lived it. And I still live it. Still one of the best movie genres, movie eras out there. And also music in general. Anyways, 80s is just amazing. It's built so much foundation for the film we have today. And a lot of people, I think, take it for granted.
Right. So, no, I totally agree.
So, yeah, you know, we've had this interesting, so, you know, coming from the height of the Batman in 89 and then teetering and then taking its sloop down, you know, as we get into Batman and Robin, just skyrocketing back up once again when we got to the Nolan series. And then again, teetering its way down. I wouldn't say so much as flopping, but just, but definitely we're just kind of, we're in this, we're ready for this next exciting phase of Batman. And as you may have seen in our trailer that we already just produced and talked about our reactions, you know, we have this Robert Pattinson one, you know, the actor coming up, and it could be good things. It really could.
Yeah, I think it has the potential to be a very dark, gritty, like your friend was, you know, like our friend was saying, detective noir style. And
right.
It's very different than anything else that's been released up until this point, as far as Batman movies go. And I think that
right.
that has the potential to be different and still be successful. I'm rooting for it.
I'm rooting for it too. And although Affleck was still, you know, dark for his role, and like he played the character pretty solid. I mean, I like Affleck as an actor, at least his later years for sure. Absolutely. Early years has been a little interesting, but yeah, it wasn't a flaw of him playing the Batman. And again, it was back to story. So if they can nail the story, if they can, but yet not repeat completely what's been done, you know, in like Nolan's movies, because again, although people want to see more awesomeness, they don't want to see the same thing.
Right.
Right.
Right. This is definitely different.
It does seem like it, right? And maybe even has a little bit of the theatricalness of, if you get, that's not a word, but you know, but the theatrics, if you will, of the earlier, like Batman Forever and Batman Returns, even back then, only because it looks like there's, again, the characters just look a little bit more interesting, you know, they just don't look like your standard villains, but thanks, you know, that's due to the makeup crews and everybody else working to make those characters come alive. So,
yeah, it definitely throwback to the Keaton films, I'll say for sure, stylistically. Yeah, like style. Tim Burton style, maybe.
Style, but yeah, but hopefully the acting will still stay, you know, to the standards,
right.
I think, of what we've seen in these days in our movies of this generation, right?
Right.
Cool.
I hope.
We hope. And so with that said, you know, there's a lot of great Batman history. I wouldn't necessarily call this a troubled history. I'd say that, you know, they've tried some things and some things didn't work. And I think DC needs to focus, at least when it comes to as a production company, they need to really focus on storyline. And there are so many great writers out there. You need to really explore your options and not just worry about the next huge name of who provides your story. Who has the best story? I don't care if it's just Joe Blow out there on the side of the street. Does he have the great story?
And it may come down to them for focusing on their TV series, because I know like the Arrowverse is very popular, and
True.
So they've had a lot of success on TV, and maybe with this new Flash movie, they can translate some of that to screen.
Okay.
I think there's some DC, there's some reason to be hopeful for DC. Unfortunately, I just don't think, at least in terms of the current rendition of the DC universe, I don't think it's rested on Batman. It's certainly not the cinema level.
Yeah, and I think this is a chance for DC to try and start shining a bit more. Like you said, they have their TV series so forth, but when it comes to the true cinema and the movie going experience, you know, the Avengers are kind of done. I mean, it's not to say they're not going to do their spinoffs and everything else, but they're just kind of this lull right now. So this is your chance to come in and say, boom, look, we can do this. So.
Right. Totally agree.
Cool. So we hope you enjoyed this talk over Batman. I'd be curious to know, what Batman movies do you love or hate, or do you fully disagree with us? Do you think Nolan's movies are trash? But if you do, you better have a darn good reason, because it'd be hard to sway my judgment, and I think Adam's too, correct?
Yeah. I mean, you're entitled to your opinion, but yeah, I love them.
Yeah, you're entitled to your opinion, but you're wrong. So... Yeah, no, but let us know some of the other movies, the ones that we thought were not so great and shaky. Do you think there's very good redeeming qualities for those, or did you feel pretty much the same way? Let us know. I'd really love to see some comments from some of you guys. So, anyways, this is the ZMM show, talking the Batman, wonderful history from 66 all the way to date. And, we'll get some new material out for you. Make sure to come out every Wednesday, like and subscribe if you are enjoying our content. And we will see you guys at the next review.
Talk to you guys later.